Welcome, everybody, to another episode of Ganbei. I'm your host, Art Dicker, and today we have the pleasure of being joined by three ex-Airbnb employees who were with Airbnb in the relatively early days of Airbnb's launch here in China. Brian Huang, founder of Antibody Tech. Welcome, Brian.
Thank you for having me, Art.
Rob Howe, co-founder and COO of Hype. Welcome, Rob.
Pleasure.
And last but not least, Ziyang David Fan, who is head of digital trade at the World Economic Forum. Welcome, Sam.
Great to be here.
So I was sent into China with one goal, which is to, in the dead of winter, to speak with 100 existing hosts and come back with a report and basically say, should we come into China? You know, it was quite funny when you think about it, looking back. The decision was made in end of 2014 and the beginning of 2015 that we need to be in China. The first office was obviously in our apartment. In the beginning, my role was primarily to bring the hosting culture that was existed in North America into China, right? And on the back of that, it was to build what we call listings or hosts in China. One thing we learned really early on was that when we looked at our competition in China, they were going after a lot of the low-hanging fruit. And where they excelled at was Dtway, like on the ground operations, right? And very similar to the Uber story and whatnot. And so if we went head to head with them to capture the quantity of hosts across different tiers of cities, we would have lost that game, to be very honest. So we decided to try and continue to invest in those high quality RTO hosts that provide and understand the DNA of hosting and can provide that unique experience to our travelers, both domestically and internationally, with the hopes that by providing these experiences later on, those guests can then go forward to become hosts themselves and in other cities of China. And we actually saw that in a lot of the analytics. Now the lifeline for that to happen, the runway for that to happen, takes a little longer of time. But I think, you know, looking back in hindsight, that was one example of where we consciously made a decision to go in a different direction in the competition because we couldn't play in their backyard.
I think this strategy is, everyone knows about it. You know, when you go into China, you got to go local, but to really how to operationalize it, that's the challenge.
It sounds like you guys had a champion from the beginning in Nate, I guess. So that was critical. I don't know, Rob, if you want to talk a bit, yeah. You mentioned it earlier.
I think many years ago, let's say half a decade ago, this concept of, you know, HQ must steer the ship and always be in the driver's seat and not provide autonomy to the local operations team was super apparent and abundant across all tech firms. But I personally believe that's changed a lot, really a lot. These founders and the board of directors of these types of companies now, they do a lot of research and they talk to people who have succeeded and failed in China. And the number one point always is, oh, we're not providing enough autonomy to the local operations team. So if you take Uber and Airbnb as an example, the common denominator that I see there is they both had executive champions at the very, very top. And those champions really unlocked everything for them, kind of like parting the Red Seas. And I think that was so critical. Every new person who joins the company, regardless if you're a C-level or even if you're a contractor, for example, you would have to pass two core value interviews. And each region or each country, every year we would elect new core value interviewers. And you have to go through core value interviewing training. And in America at HQ, we had a core values council.
But Airbnb has an ICP license in China, which is puts it in kind of rare company.
The ICP is kind of like the golden key that opens mm-hmm. a gate and allows you inside. ICP stands for Internet Content Provider. So ICP license is the Internet Content Provider license. It's a government issued license in this case by MMIT that would allow a China-based website to legally operate mm-hmm. in China. So in a way, and especially if you sell advertisements, yeah. You know, there's commercial activity involved. So that's what it does. Find good local partners you work with, in particular, for example, law firms. find good law firms that understand your needs and also can be creative. Give a shout out to TransAsia, to Philip Chu, great lawyer, if anyone wants to do the same. Also, a web hosting partner, right? Mm-hmm. So it could be, you know, a local one, it could be a joint venture, right? It could be Aliwin, could be AWS. They are a critical part of obtaining the ICP license, because technically they actually submit the license on your behalf. Right. So finding a right web hosting company is important. To allocate dedicated resources on this license application. This is not just any business license you can do within, you know, 21 days. This takes all teams with the S effort. So each team, IT, operations, business, product, is really our team effort. So this needs to go to the top of your agenda.
Your whole infrastructure have several different components. For Airbnb, you search the listing and you proceed with the select date in the calendar and you proceed with the payment. That's each component is already big. You need to break them down and consider that each part and find out a workable solution for make sure the local customer can get a great experience. All the works have a lot of engineering and product resource working behind the scene to make it really works.
We had people, engineers across numerous departments, you know, analytics, risk, payments, front end, back end. We had an international team as well as a Chinese team who volunteered to say, put me on the China product. The ICP kind of decision, I think, was, you know, there's that is kind of like a threshold for companies, right? Because if you cross that threshold, then what you're signaling to Chinese netizens as well as Chinese consumers is that we are committed, you know, we are committed to offering you the best user experience and the best product that we can provide. And internally, it's also another decision that says, in order to cross that threshold, we're willing to, you know, do things a little differently internally. Certainly there was competition here. It didn't really solidify until we went public about, not sorry, not IPO. I mean, when we went public about our entrance into China around 2015. And that's when you saw the big companies, Tuja, Xiaozhu, and maybe even like at that time, Qunar was doing a short-term rental platform as well. And they were getting funded left, right, and center. And it was difficult for us because, like as I said earlier, we were at crossroads. You know, we knew what they were doing. They were going mass. They were going to the local classic tourist destinations like Huanshan, and they would take all the little apartments near these classic destinations, which we were not present in. You know. And then they would get those tier 4 or 5 city travelers to use their properties. And then as those travelers mature in their travel, let's say progression, and they move up to bigger cities like Shanghai, Beijing, Shenzhen, the top of mind is either hotels or Tujiao or Xiaozhu. And then the idea was that if this continued to progress, then at one point Tujiao could go to our backyard, Thailand, Vietnam, Japan, Korea, Singapore, Malaysia, and also get listings and say, hey, now that you've matured significantly and you're ready to go to Japan, you should use us because you've been using us for the last 4 years anyways, right? Mm. But we really stuck to our guns. We said, no, we can't go deep yet. We need to stay here with the assumption that when they reach that threshold of maturity, they would jump. You know, they would say, okay, I'm going to use Airbnb to go to Japan.
Whatever vertical you're in, various e-commerce apps, the interface is exactly the same. How did you handle that for Airbnb in China?
For Airbnb, I think we're really strong on brand, and we want to keep the same experience for no matter the traveler or the host from the Asia, Europe, or China. We want to keep the same experience for them. So I think from the product interaction with the user, we want to keep the experience as much as possible in line with the global one. And I think for the user side, they are willing to accept the same experience as well. By doing that, we actually have a lot of, we need a lot of investment on the product and tech side, a lot of engineers and product manager working on that to make sure that's fully localized and be liked by the China users.
All the user research we got back on the search bar, just take for example the search bar, was click to search, right? You get the top 50 destinations and you click, that's what's common here. And our product manager here and over there were like, okay, this is what the feedback we're getting. We have to do click to search. Nobody is typing in destinations. And I don't remember exactly who made the decision, but we decided not to do that. Yes, it's true at that time. And perhaps even today, people are accustomed to click to search, but that kind of went against what we stood for. We stood for adventure and exploration, right? So we wanted people to type and to explore both kind of mentally and physically, tactically.
I stayed at a lot of Airbnbs in Beijing. I remember there was one, in one Airbnb, the lady, it was her first time, I was an old lady, like an auntie, which is not a typical profile. It just happened that night, I think, she forgot to pay her electric bill or something, like electricity went out. So it was like middle of July, it was scorching hot, and I ended up calling the company and paying, you know, like a, you know, 50 quai electric bill or something, so the AC can run. So next morning she came back, she heard about it, she was super apologetic when I told her it's all fixed. She was so moved, and I think she shared some tears, right? So I think it's this two-way street, right? The host caring for guests, and then also the guest, you know, taking care of the host. That is that kind of experience that makes Airbnb very special and very hard for other competitors to replicate. One of the, if not the biggest takeaway of my time at Airbnb and just watching the virtual bell ring, it just be surrounded by this close friends. You know, we spend so many hours and time together, and just faced, you know, what was a crazy but fun ride,